Hello, this is Seher from Easy Peasy, and the topic we're going to discuss today is called eukaryotic DNA replication. Okay, now before I start discussing the process of replication, we should understand what is the difference between eukaryotes and prokaryotes. Now, the U from eukaryotes stands for good, well, or true, while karyotes come from a Greek word kratos, and it stands for nuts. It means all the cells that have good, well, or true nut-like structure in it is called eukaryotes. And that nut-like structure is basically the nucleus with the nuclear membrane and nucleoli. And the genetic material DNA is present inside that nucleus. Now look at the picture. In prokaryotes, this DNA is present within the cytoplasm, while in eukaryotes, you have a good, well, or true rounded structure called nucleus in it. So that's the difference. Fine. Now, if I look at the six kingdoms, I can find these eukaryotic organisms covering four different kingdoms there. So, eukaryotic organisms are really important to us, and to understand the DNA replication in it is really important. So, that's why I took a eukaryotic cell in front of you. In this eukaryotic cell, the DNA is present within the nucleus and in mitochondria. Now we know about the nucleus that all the genes that is necessary for our survival is present within the nucleus. But why the DNA is present in mitochondria? The answer of this question is within its function. The function of mitochondria is to generate energy. That's why it's called powerhouse of the cell, right? So all the enzymes that is necessary for phosphorylation and dephosphorylation to make ATP molecules there is coming from the genes that is present within the mitochondria. So mitochondria is basically independent of all the other organelles there, and that's why they're generating the energy within our cells. Fine? Okay. Now I take the nucleus because DNA is present in it, and within the nucleus I find all different kind of organelles there. Now I selected three, like in the green boxes there, nucleopore, nucleoplasm, and nuclear envelope. These three organelles are involved in the process of protection and transportation of molecules and enzymes from cytoplasm to the nucleus and from nucleus to cytoplasm. Fine. Now, nucleolus. This organelle is basically synthesizing ribosomes there, and chromatin is the thing that we are looking for and that have the DNA structure or heredity information in it. Fine. Now we'll take the chromatin material, and we can see that they are present in the form of chromosomes. The chromosome structure is in front of you. It has two small arms called p-arm. They are joined at a junction of centromere there, and the long arms are called Q arms there. They are also coiled upon proteins named as histone proteins there. Fine. But these chromosomes are not visible with our naked eye. Even if we try to look at in the microscope, we cannot find it because chromosomes can only be visible to us when the cell is in the dividing state. Okay, so they are not visible in a normal state, but once the cell is going to divide, these chromosomes will be visible to us in the microscope. Fine. Okay, now I take that double-stranded DNA, and now I need to find out that how to open it up. So this is the strand for me. Fine. Now, just like in prokaryotes, within the DNA helical structure, we do have specific locations where we can find a specific kind of sequence. And this sequence is called as origin of replication sequence. Just remember, in prokaryotes, we just have one origin of replication, but as in eukaryotes, we have a lot of different chromosomes. Within human body, we have 23 pairs of chromosomes, right? So we have a lot of genetic material. So that's why we need a lot of different origin of replications to speed up the process. Fine. Now, the sequence we have within this origin of replication consists of repetitive common nucleotides, and it is called consensus sequence. They are also rich in AT segments or AT nucleotides. Why? Because adenine make two hydrogen bonds with thymine, while guanine make three different bonds with cytosine. To break two bonds is a lot easier than to break three bonds. That's why the segments that is going to open up have AT-rich segments there. Fine? Make sense? Okay. Next. Next is I take this DNA strand and the origin of replications. Now, this is a group of protein, and this protein is basically called the pre-replication complex. These proteins are going to join on the top of the origin of replication, and they allow the double-stranded DNA to open up within the origin of replication. So this strand will look like this for us. Fine. Now keep in mind, pre-replication complex just open up the DNA within the origin of replication. But what about the strand that is not present within the origin of replication? For that, we have another enzyme, and that enzyme is called helicases. That's going to open up the strand that is present beside the origin of replication. Now we're talking about eukaryotes, right? So in eukaryotes, we have CMG helicase, and these are again a group of different proteins attached with each other, performing the same function. Fine? Now, the DNA is open up. So these single-stranded DNA is very likely to have the degradation process because they are open, they are spare, so nucleases can attack them. They can also coil back again. So to keep them open up, we need a kind of protein that needs to maintain the structure. So we have tiny different proteins attached to these structures, and these proteins are called as single-stranded binding proteins. Fine. Now, when these proteins are attached with single strands, the DNA single strands are not going in the process of degradation then. Bingo. Okay. Now, I'm taking only this point of general replication. Now, when the DNA opens up, the strand that is present on the side basically got supercoiled like this on both sides. Now, there are two conditions. If this DNA coils in clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. If it's clockwise, then it is positive supercoil. And if it is anti-clockwise or counterclockwise direction, then it is a negative supercoil. And we cannot afford that, because if the supercoil is there, it means there is a chance that DNA is going to break at some point and create mutations. And that is really, really difficult for us to survive in that situation, right? So we cannot afford supercoiling. How we can avoid supercoiling? We have another protein that take care of this job, and the protein that is going to unwind the supercoiling thing is called DNA topoisomerases. Now, DNA topoisomerases consist of two different types called type 1 and type 2. And these types are further subdivided into type A and type B. Now, why they are subdivided? Because type A forms a covalent bond with the 5' end of the DNA, and type B binds with the 3' end of the DNA. So the binding locations are different. That's why they have subtype A and B. Now, why we have two different types, type 1 and type 2 there? Because type 1 only produces one breakage in one strand only, while type 2 can break both strands in the DNA replication process. Fine. So this is the difference in type 1 and type 2 of a DNA topoisomerases. Fine. Now the DNA is opened up. We know that, right? And we know that they have 3' end and 5' ends on it. The new DNA that's going to form there can only be formed from the direction of 5' to 3' end. Now look at the strand above. If that's a strand we have, then there is no problem. We can attach a new strand to it from 5' to 3' end, right? But if we are making the new daughter strand from the strand below, we will have a problem here because the strand below is already from 5 prime to 3 prime end, right? In this case, a small tiny fragments are generated, and the upper strand is called leading strand and the lower strand is called lagging strand, and the small fragments that is generating here is called Okazaki fragments. Fine. Okay, now I just took the open single-stranded DNA on both sides and see how these parental DNAs is gonna replicate into the daughter strands. Fine. Now, DNA nucleotides cannot attach themselves directly with the parental DNA strand. They need a helper, and the helper they have is called RNA primer. Now, if the DNA strand have the nucleotides A, T, A, and C, RNA primer will have the complementary nucleotides there. So instead of T, they will have uracil there. For thymine, they will add adenine. For adenine, again, uracil. And for cytosine, they will attach guanine with it. So that's the RNA primer. Now the question is, why we are using RNA primer? Why not DNA primer, right? Because in RNA primer, on the sugar molecule, we have OH on the carbon number 2. In DNA, we don't have that OH over there. So that's the problem. This OH is needed to attach the first nucleotide to the parental DNA. And that's why we're using RNA primer, not DNA primer. Fine? Okay. Now, RNA primer is there, and it is made by an enzyme called primase. Again, the primase is having a group of proteins there, and these proteins are going to attach to the strand and make this RNA primer for us. Fine. If you did remember the prokaryotic DNA replication, that prokaryotic DNA replication primase is called DNAG, and that is only a single protein, have three subunits over there. Okay. But in case of eukaryotic organisms, we have a bunch of different proteins there, okay? Now, the RNA primer in eukaryotes can be extended from 10 to 20 nucleotides approximately, fine? Now, the orangish protein you can see over there, this is protein polymerase alpha, and that is basically the major protein there attaching the RNA nucleotides and make RNA primer for us. Fine. Okay. Now the RNA primer is made. We need to attach the DNA nucleotides with it, right? So now to attach those DNA nucleotides, we are using polymerase. In eukaryotes, for leading strand, the polymerase we're going to use here is called polymerase epsilon. Fine. That is in green, parrot green color here. That's why I just mentioned it over there. It also has another protein attached with it in the color of red, and this protein is called proliferating cell nuclear antigen. And this is a clamp of kind of structure, you can say, that is like going to attach this group of proteins within the nucleotides so that they cannot go away from it. Fine. Now the blue circles you can see in this picture is basically the helicases. Remember this helicase? We didn't discuss it. CMG helicases, that is opening up the DNA strand for us. Bingo. Okay, now these group of proteins move like this and attach one by one the DNA nucleotides for us. Okay, so that was the story for leading strand. What about the lagging strand, right? In lagging strand, we need to make the Okazaki fragments. So again, we're going to take the primase, and this primase is making the RNA primer there. So this is the primer for us. And then the polymerase came here to extend the DNA nucleotides with it. But just remember here, okay, for lagging strand, the polymerase we are using here is called polymerase delta. For leading strand, it was polymerase epsilon. For lagging strand, we have a different kind of polymerase. Fine. Again, it is attached with another kind of protein here, and that is acting as a clamping region for us. Fine. If you did remember the prokaryotic DNA replication that I discussed before, we had polymerase 3 that was taking care of leading strand and lagging strand over there, and the clamping was done with the subunit of that polymerase 3. But that's not the case here. We have a different protein called proliferating cell nuclear antigen to extend or to clamp the polymerase with the strand. Fine? Okay. Now this polymerase is again going to move and attach the DNA nucleotide for us. Okay. Now, how the RNA primer is going to get removed from the nucleotides? Fine. Now this polymerase delta is moving, right? And when it encounters to another primer, the RNA primer attaching with another nucleotide strand there, when they come in contact with each other, the RNA primer moves up like this, and it is called a single-stranded RNA flap. And when it makes a flap kind of structure, another protein called nucleases come to attack it, and they will degrade this RNA primer. Fine? Okay. Now the RNA primer is removed, and now we need to replace this RNA primer position with DNA nucleotides, right? To complete this job, we have a specific kind of protein called polymerase beta for it, and this polymerase beta is gonna convert the RNA primer nucleotides into the DNA nucleotides there, or fill the gap there. Fine? Okay. Now the DNA nucleotides are made, but they are not attached. They are in pieces, right? Which protein is going to use here to attach all these fragments together? We have a separate protein for us, and this is called DNA ligase. This DNA ligase attaches itself to all the strands and then join them together. Fine? Now we have smooth new daughter strand of DNA without any RNA primer there, right? Okay. Now here, for example, if that's a strand we have, or the daughter strand, how we know that we need to end the process of replication, right? At the end of the parental DNA, like at the end of the chromosomes, we have a specific region having specific repetitive nucleotides there, and that nucleotide is called telomeres for us. This is a really big topic. I will discuss this topic in a separate video, but right now I can just say that this telomere is basically a part of parental DNA, and it is a non-coding sequence, and they are repetitive, like A, G, G, T, T is going to repeat itself again and again, and then they will make a hairpin kind of structure, and that's how the DNA replication ends itself. But I will discuss these telomeres in my next video in more detail. Fine? Okay, so by this process, we can end the process of replication, and that's it. Now let's recap the differences between prokaryotic DNA replication and eukaryotic DNA replication. In prokaryotic DNA replication, we just have one origin of replication, while in eukaryotic DNA replication, we have several different points of origin of replications there. Fine. Okay, the second difference is that we had DNA A protein that was attaching to the origin of replication and opening it up. In eukaryotes, we have a bunch of different proteins called pre-replication complex, and these protein is opening up the DNA within the origin of replication. Now, in prokaryotes, the other DNA strand is going to open up by helicase name as DNA B, while in eukaryotes we have CMG helicase, and this is again a group of proteins there. Okay, in prokaryotic DNA replication, we have a primase that is called DNA G, and they have three different subunits over there, right? While in eukaryotes, we have again a group of different proteins attached to it, and the major protein here is polymerase alpha. Okay, for the replication or attaching the nucleotide, the DNA nucleotide with the strand, in prokaryotes, we had polymerase 3, While in eukaryotes, for leading strand, we have polymerase epsilon, and for lagging strand, we had polymerase delta. Okay, for the removal of RNA primer, we have DNA polymerase 1 in prokaryotes, while in eukaryotes, the RNA primer is going to remove by making a single-stranded RNA flap there. DNA polymerase 1 in prokaryotes replaces the RNA primer with the DNA over there, while the DNA formed within the eukaryotes are done by polymerase beta. The termination process are also different, but I didn't discuss the termination process in detail. That's why I didn't put that difference here. Okay, thank you very much. If you like this video, please hit the button like and please subscribe my channel. Thank you. Bye-bye.